Welcome to the Brain Coffee Podcast, where Drs. Eric Luthart and Albert Kim unlock life's little mysteries about health, wellness, entertainment, technology, and how the brain makes sense of it all. Sit back, relax, and open up your mind.
That kolache was amazing.
Yeah, this is a good breakfast treat. I mean, what does kolache mean? What is that from, by the way?
I think it's Polish. I think I could be wrong on that, but...
Yeah, we're gonna have like a Polish uprising now if that's wrong.
that's right. Yeah. Or another uprising if that's wrong. Yeah, you're right. Right.
Anyway, that was yummy.
I'm gonna probably be spending a little bit of time working the kolache off.
Oh yeah, maybe a couple of thousand extra calories. Yeah.
right.
Yeah, but it's so hard to maintain consistent discipline in exercising. I mean, everybody, right?
Now, how often are you exercising these days? Would you say?
I would say I do about 20 minutes. Cardiovascular 3 times a week, something like that.
I'm trying to do 4 or 5, but I absolutely agree that this good habit or perseverance is challenging.
Yeah, no. These Olympians, you know, the Winter Olympics are coming up. How these people must be training. What kind of discipline and grit that must take to make it to that level of achievement, you know?
Well, the neuroscience of grit is people always assume that, like, with grit, that people relish the pain of it. Right, you know, that people, you know, enjoy the agony and somehow move through the agony, but it's actually really the pleasure principle actually still governs. It's actually how much dopamine your brain produces that compels you to do these behaviors again and again. So people are able to, when they exercise, produce, you know, things that make them feel good that actually lead them to do it more and more.
Yeah. Why do you exercise?
Well, again, at the end of the day, it makes me feel good
about myself.
And my body. You're not like, and, like, my health. And,
exactly. It's not the discipline of it.
My brain's in a good place.
It's an interesting part of grit, huh? You kind of, it involves so much discipline and willpower, but it ends up being something you want to do. So that, what's the trick behind that?
How do you convert, how do you convert that kind of that pain, what is initially a painful activity into something that's pleasurable that you seek out?
So they're like, well, I guess we could break it apart, right? There's really stressful events like, you know, disasters, war, loss of a loved one, things like that, that'll stress you out, and you have to get through those sorts of things. And we've discussed this before. That's like the cortisol system.
That's right.
Right?
That's
hypothalamus turns on, that signals to the pituitary gland, and you release stress hormones from your kidney. And that amps up, well, that and the sympathetic nervous system amps up everything. I don't know, that's probably good in the immediate sense, but then you have to sort of get past that. You have to cope with that, right?
Yeah, and I think that learning is probably dopamine driven.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and so I think one of the things, actually this makes me think of a quote. Let me see if I can remember it. It's by Nietzsche, actually. He says, to live is to suffer, to survive suffering is to find meaning. It plays well with that idea, is that, you know, you get that stress, you get those events, you know. But the thing is, the interesting thing about stress is a certain amount we like. Right, like, so for instance, we like to go on roller coasters. We like to go, you know, on, you know, we like to see a scary movie. The things that, you know, kind of give us some stress and some, you know, kind of, you know, cortisol, but too much and it becomes destructive.
It's something we can manage, exactly. Right. So the question is how we can surmount that initial acute spike in stress and sympathetic drive.
Such that it's not destructive.
Exactly, and that we can, our bodies are better, so we're more resilient, let's say,
in the
future.
That's right. I think resilience is a great word, because how do we kind of encounter, how do we both sometimes seek out those events and how do we better deal with them? And I guess the question is, you know, how do we, you know, better enable kind of our dopamine system to participate in that remodeling? And because people do talk about grit and perseverance gets better with practice.
Right.
That, and again, when we think about breaking it down, we can also think about the different, you know, kind of parts of the brain that are involved in that. You know, it's, for instance, it's, again, to go through some of the commonly held names and the more technical ones, it's medial frontal lobe, striatum. Striatum is what produces a lot of dopamine.
Yep, for sure. Basal ganglia and striatum, yep.
And then our basal frontal lobes. These are areas that are associated with emotions, focus, and kind of pleasure and pain. So I think one of the things that we can probably control is the emotional aspect. Perhaps that's why when you exercise, it's good to have a trainer, because that emotional bonding, you know, like having positive emotions when you start helps create the habits that lead to further dopamine production.
Like having that positive relationship
exactly
fuels your the discipline and, you know, just having a relationship with a person. I agree with that. Another thing you could do is, like, for instance, visualization.
Absolutely.
You know, you apply, you see something, you see yourself doing it, and you have positive thoughts while you're doing it.
Yeah.
Maybe it's like you're pushing a button, a dopamine button, while you're looking at, seeing yourself doing exercise.
Well, I think the brain's really interesting in this. We've had a lot of experience with visualization with brain-computer interfaces. Mm-hmm. Because one of the things that we've really come to learn is that whether you see it, you do it, or you imagine it, it looks virtually identical in the brain's physiology. So kind of visualization is really having your brain do something.
I can believe that. I mean,
and so the more you can visualize, the more profound it trains your brain to do stuff. So I think that visualization is kind of a pre-practice, if you will,
right,
to get you in the zone.
I mean, it's kind of like this, I don't know if you remember that movie, Unforgiven.
Oh, sure, yeah.
Clint Eastwood, yeah. You know, he's old guy, his reflexes can't be any good. But that, at the end of the movie, and I'm not advocating gun violence or anything like that, but I mean, at the end of the movie, he is able to basically take care of what he needs to, because his presence of mind is there. His, mm-hmm. you know, he's basically visualized that whole scenario many times before, and he's right. able to basically make it happen. Whereas these young whippersnappers,
they have to think through each step.
Exactly, they haven't seen it before in their minds. Yeah.
Well, so. You know, I remember Malcolm Gladwell talks about this in terms of experts. So, as an example, Wayne Gretzky, you mm-hmm. know, he cited him as well as Charlie Wilson.
Yeah.
These kind of master experts basically kind of chunk information. Like, they can visualize and see things, you know, in a whole that, like, a non-expert has to do in little parts. And the more you can kind of consolidate information, the faster, you know, you can deal with it. So, for instance, I think one of the really interesting things about hockey, for instance, is that, you know, people always talk about the reaction times. You know, you've got a hockey puck that's coming at you, you know, what, 100 miles an hour?
Yeah, from just, like, I don't know, 10, 20 feet away.
Right, and you've got less than a tenth of a second to deal with it.
Right.
And are they are not thinking about that hockey puck at the moment that it's coming at them. They see kind of the totality of the experience to know that there is very likely a hockey puck at this moment in time. And the more practice they get at that cumulative experience, the more their brain is prepared to react, even before it really is actually getting the sensory input. So for instance, if they actually have to see and process a hockey puck, they're going to miss it.
Right.
But if they see in this process the scenario that a hockey puck is soon to arrive their way, they're already prepared for
it. Yeah, I agree with that. There's probably some physical limit to your reaction time per se. You know, that's probably governed by, I don't know, like your genes and your development. And
your myelination.
And definitely. The insulation for the wires. Yeah,
that's
but
right.
I mean, I'm not sure if everyone can achieve the same absolute, you know.
That's hard to know. But I think that there's probably things, again, as we think about kind of like total information processing.
Right.
That, for instance, maybe things like virtual reality, like that can allow them to experience things at a higher rate to learn to kind of, not, probably they aren't reacting to the puck, they're predicting the puck.
Yeah, I agree.
And so that their reaction time is really a prediction of the puck coming towards them. So if you had things like virtual reality or systems where basically they are completely experiencing a game and reacting to it, that allows them to start to consolidate that information better, that actually may increase their reaction.
Yeah, I agree. Maybe they're not distracted by other things, and so they have the presence of mind, again, to see and react to that puck, again, with the best of their own natural abilities.
That's right. Yeah, that's right.